Hey YouTube, this is Praxis Prepper, and welcome to my second installment in my Not Dying During Nuclear War survival series. I still don't have a good name for it. I'm sorry about that. Today we're going to be talking all about shelter and sheltering. There's two basic types. One is getting shelter from the initial blast, the heat, the shockwave, all of that. And the second type of sheltering that usually associate is from the residual fallout after the fact. So let's get through my dumbass intro and then we'll get down to it. So if you've been watching my series, you know that what I've been doing is I've been taking information from books, websites, other media, and distilling it down into a really dense package so that it's easily digestible and you don't have to spend time searching for it everywhere. It's been very informative to me, and I hope that I can share that with you. One of the books that I'm going to be using a lot specifically today is this one by Cresson Kearney, Nuclear War Survival Skills, which is a much better title than I have for my series. I would highly recommend that you get at the very minimum, a download of this book. You can buy it, it's about $15 to get it, but you can also download it for free online, and I would highly recommend doing it. I'm going to put a little link right here so that you can go right to it. Get it for yourself. There's so much great information. I'm going to be going over sort of what is available to you, and then you can go into the book and get the actual information, because I don't want to make this a 2 or 3 hour documentary about all the details. So get this book. Like I said, it's free. It's a free download online. They want to get the information out there. By Cresson Kearney, Nuclear War Survival Skills. If the link is dead, if the book gets moved for whatever reason, just do a Google search for that. There's lots of locations where you can get it. So we're talking about sheltering. And like I said, there's two different types. There's the sheltering from fallout, and we're going to spend most of our time talking about that today. And the other type is sheltering from the initial blast. And we'll talk about the blast first, both because chronologically it happens first, and also it's a lot simpler. We don't have to go on and on that much about it. First off, if you're out in the open, there's an explosion in the sky, what you want to do is you want to shelter from that as best you can and improvise with your location. You can get behind, at the very minimum, like a stone wall. You can get behind a ditch, underneath a culvert or something like that will shield you from it. If you're in an urban environment, getting into a very strong masonry building, something like pre-World War II, just with really thick walls. And what you want to do is get out of that intense heat and light and, potentially the blast wave as well. A lot of locations, if you're outside and there's a nuclear bomb that goes off over you, it's not going to work out well for you. But what we're talking about is people who are on that periphery, who have a chance if they have the right information. So get yourself behind something. You want it. It's pretty much keeping your skin from being exposed to the intense heat and gamma radiation that comes out of the fireball initially. It's kind of like the worst sunburn that you ever get in your life. So just get kind of in a shadow and stay there for a few minutes. That is the shelter that you should be looking for from the initial blast. After that, you want to get to what's called a fallout shelter, and that's where it gets a little bit more detailed. And there's lots of different fallout shelters. There are 6 very rudimentary fallout shelters that you can make within 48 hours that are available in this book for you. There's also permanent fallout shelters that you can create, and we're going to talk about that as well. The critical element of a fallout shelter is its ability to shield you from radiation, and that happens in 2 different ways. One is through geometry shielding, and the other is through barrier shielding. And barrier shielding is just what it sounds like. There is a barrier between you and the radioactive fallout. And I took some notes right here because I'm not going to remember this. The amount of barrier shielding that it takes to cut down the radiation by half depends on what you're making it out of. If you have about 3.5 inches of packed earth, only about half the radiation will get through that. If you have about 2.5 inches of concrete, only about half the radiation will penetrate through that. Or if you have 2.75 inches of water, only about half the radiation will penetrate through that. So as you can see, depending on the material that you're using to shield yourself, different distances of that material are going to be effective at cutting down the radiation by half. You don't want to stop at half, obviously. You know, just getting half of whatever's outside around you, is, depending on where you are, may still be a fatal dose. So what you think of it as is your first halving distance cuts it by half. You put another halving distance, and now we're down to 1/4. You put another halving distance, now we're down to 1/8, you know, 1/16, 1/32, and you keep going down from that. That's called your protection factor, how much distance you have there to protect you. The other type of shielding that is available is geometry shielding. That's not particularly obvious what that means necessarily. What that's talking about is distance from something, or using corners and angles to protect yourself. If you think about like a flashlight, if someone takes a flashlight, shines it right in your face, there's a lot of intensity there. There's a lot of photons hitting you. If they walk back, distance over distance over distance, it's going to get less and less and less. That's a type of geometry shielding, getting yourself further away from that that source of radiation, or in the example of light. Bouncing around corners. Just like a flashlight, if you go around a corner and someone is shining the flashlight at you, most of the flashlight's beam is going to keep going, but some of it's going to maybe bounce off of another wall, and it'll kind of bounce on your face from there, or some of it may be bouncing off of mist that's in the air. So some of that may be able to go around a corner and still strike you, and it's the same for light and for radiation. But obviously, the more corners you protect yourself around, the less of that's going to be striking you. So those are the two basic techniques that are used for creating a fallout shelter. Now, there are a few different ways of going about building a fallout shelter. As you can see behind me, I've started work on a permanent fallout shelter. And this is sort of the classic sort of freak out bomb shelter from the 1950s. It's about 6 feet wide by about 12 feet. It's got a little entryway where you can go in using some of that geometry shielding as the entryway kind of bends through. But I'm not just building this for a fallout shelter, because that'd be crazy. I'm also making a root cellar out of it. So that's a way I'm going to get total use out of this structure right now. Well, you know, when it's done. It'll be an asset to me whether or not there's a nuclear war. So it doesn't seem at all crazy to me, because I'm going to get benefit out of this no matter what happens. So I'm going to talk about that a little bit more at the end of the video. But for right now, what I want to talk about is what's called expedient shelters, things you could throw up quickly. And by quickly, that I'm talking about within a couple of days. And again, this book has some great designs in it. Download this book right now. I'm not going to go over the details in here. I'm just going to talk about what's available to you. There are 6 very, well, reasonably detailed designs right in the appendices of this book that you can get out. And all of them can be built within about 48 hours. And the idea of 48 hours is if there were to be an imminent attack, whatever that aggressor would be, you know, unless it's some kind of like a terrorist organization, but if it is another state, they're probably going to be beginning to evacuate their cities. So the thinking is that people would probably get about a 48-hour warning if things are really going to go up to that level, because cities will start evacuating and you're like, oh shit, you know, this could get hot. Maybe we should build a very quick fallout shelter. And these designs can be done in that amount of time. The basic idea is that you're digging a hole in the ground, putting a roof on it, and getting as much earth onto that as possible. The considerations you need to take in mind is getting enough earth on there. You want to make it structurally sound, and that's why you should download or buy this book, because there's all sorts of information structurally on how you can avoid killing yourself. And you want to make sure that you're getting enough air in there so that you're not going to suffocate yourself and then run out like after, you know, a day or so. Be like, I don't care. I want to just be out of there. I'm all claustrophobic. So, because the idea is that you may have to be in this fallout shelter for a couple of weeks. So you want to make it livable in that environment. The next type of approach to creating a fallout shelter is to work sort of with what you already have. A lot of people think you can go into your basement as a fallout shelter. And that is helpful, that's effective, you have a lot of earth around you, but if, okay, I'm going to address this a different way. it offers you pretty much no protection from above. I know you've got a house over you, but as far as gamma radiation is concerned, that might as well be transparent. It can go right through it. So you can shelter in your basement, but you need to make some improvements first. Now, in this book, which is written by Cressen Kearney and you should download right now, there are pretty detailed instructions for how you can sort of retrofit your house. And I'm going to describe them lightly to you, and you will see that these are the kind of things you only want to do in like an actual emergency, because it kind of sucks to go through it, but if the alternative is dying, you know, then it's awesome. And what he talks about is taking dirt and shoveling it onto your floor above your basement to create a barrier over your head. So, you know, it's not the kind of thing you want to do unless you really think that there's going to be an issue. He doesn't say in the book, and I would recommend, maybe put a tarp down first. That was the first thing that I was thinking. I'm reading is like, oh, geez, you know, at least, you know, put a tarp down, dude. You know, you may want to clean that up later. So maybe put a tarp down, and he talks about putting about a foot of earth on your floor and then going down into the basement and bracing up all of your floor joists. And he goes into the detail on how, you know, how far your spacing should be and how you could build those supports. But basically, you want to put a beam across all your joists and then put a post under it. And you want to do that every three joists or so. And the reason that you put the dirt on first, instead of reinforcing your floor first, is you want to have the joist start to take some of that load. And then you want to put the post underneath. And then you actually put another foot of dirt on top of your floor. So ultimately, you would have 2 feet of dirt on your floor. If you can't dig dirt, you know, if it's winter, or if you've paved everywhere in your yard for miles and miles and there's just no dirt accessible, there's other things you can use. You can stack books. You could use, you know, containers of water. You know, it just went through my mind that if you had a really good plastic sheet, you could kind of work like a water reservoir, which, you know, obviously has issues if it started to leak or something like that. But there's all sorts of things that you could put on the floor. You want to think about the idea of having about 90 pounds of stuff per square foot on your floor to get you some kind of effective shielding. And then your basement becomes an environment that is reasonably shielded from the outside. Now, if you want to go the route that I'm going and pre-build a dedicated fallout shelter that's also a root cellar, so you can get some use out of it. There are a lot of different ways you can do that. There's a lot of different designs. The basic idea is that you want to dig down into the ground, and I've dug down here as far as I could go before I really just started hitting too many giant boulders. I've rolled out as many as I could, but ultimately there was one that was probably like 3 feet by 3 feet by like 4 or 5 feet that I was not going to be able to roll that out. I've done the entire thing by hand. You know, you could obviously do it with machinery and go a little deeper. That boulder, I ended up digging a large hole next to it and prying it down into the hole, and I got rid of it that way. But that established the floor. That was as far as down as I could go. I'm going to be doing 8-inch thick walls on all the sides. Those are going to go up, I think about 6 feet. I want to be able to stand up in it. I think just for, you know, sanity, it's nice to be able to stand up. And I've gotten down low enough where 6 feet gets me just about to the level of the driveway there. So that will be where cement ceiling goes in. And there's all sorts of directions in this book, which you should download right now, and then may possibly also buy in case there's, like, you know, a nuclear war and the grid goes down and you can't use your computer. It's starting to rain out here. Is this a waterproof book? You could actually use this for nuclear shielding, couldn't you? Pretty thick. So there's information down here about how to pour a cement roof and all that. And then on top of that, you want to be piling up, you know, several feet of dirt to really get yourself, you know, protected. The entrance, I'm going to use, like I said, geometry shielding. So there's going to be an entrance that goes in here and then turns 90 degrees and then turns 90 degrees again to go to a door. And what you can do for the door, if you don't want to buy like multiple lead doors, which, I don't know, I was at Home Depot the other day. I didn't see where they were displaying their lead doors. So you can use kind of regular storm doors or build your own, but obviously they're not going to stop much radiation. So what I'm planning on doing is using stackable water jugs to move in front of the door if I ever need to use it as a fallout shelter. I figured that about 3 of them across by about 5 of them high will cover up the entire door, and I'll fill them with drinkable water, which I can use as my water supply during a crisis. And obviously, as I drink through them, they would, you know, start revealing the door, but then the radiation levels outside would be slowly diminishing. Anyway, so it seems like a reasonable plan to me to do that. You also want to make great considerations for ventilation. You need to get air in there. You want to filter the air, obviously, for any fine fallout particles that might be in the air. But you want to remove as much of that dust physically as you can, just so you're not clogging up your filters. And one way of doing that is having a rather large vent pipe to take in the air with a nice gooseneck. So the pipe comes up and does a gooseneck and then goes down. And the reason you want a large diameter pipe is because if you have a small pipe and you're trying to suck in air, the air is rushing up into that small space. But if you have a larger pipe and you're pumping in the same volume of air, there's not nearly as much of that kind of sucking action. So pieces of particles, dust in the air, isn't going to get sucked up that large pipe as much. You want to screen that pipe so that you're not having insects fly in and plaguing you. But you don't want to put a screen straight across it because that might impede the airflow. So you may want to make kind of like a bagged screen around the bottom of it. You want to account for the idea that there could be fires outside, depending on where you are. So whatever sticks up out of the ground, you want to make out of something that's not going to necessarily be burning. You know, PVC pipe coming up out of the ground, under many circumstances, may be fine, but if a fire comes through, your pipe's going to be gone. So you want to make considerations for that. And also because of fire, you want to be able to close your ventilation system. If smoke starts coming in, you want to be able to make sure that that smoke stays outside and, you know, let the fires burn through, and then you can open things up again after that. If in your area a high water table may be an issue, make sure that you have some kind of a hand-operated pump that you can use to pump water to the outside. In my location, I'm not particularly concerned with that. We have pretty good drainage here, but you don't want to turn your shelter into a swimming pool if you get a bunch of rain and then you have to evacuate into the fallout because you're going to drown inside. Also, on the topic of evacuation, you want to make sure that you have two egresses in and out of the structure. And obviously, you have your primary, and the backup doesn't have to be a convenient way of getting out, but let's say there's a fire or there's just, you know, blast and debris, you may not be able to get out through your first door. Something may have happened. So it's important that you have an additional way of getting out, otherwise you've created a big cement tomb for yourself. As for lighting, you can bring in, battery-operated lights. I plan on putting a little bit of electricity in here, and I'm going to power it off of some of my solar panels. You never know with a situation with an EMP if any of that stuff may be operable. So it's nice if you have other backups. I'm trying to stay away from candles or lanterns because they'll be eating up oxygen and creating pollution in the air inside. So to just keep things cleaner, I'm planning on installing some light tubes. Now, light tubes are normally just filled with air and, you know, reflective surface, and the light comes in and then shines through. That would also be a conduit for radiation to come into a fallout shelter. So while those light tubes would work great for my root cellar concept, I need to modify those to be used if this is going to be an effective fallout shelter. So what I plan on doing with those is I'm going to take PVC tubing, probably white, paint the inside with like a chrome reflective paint, and then use a clear end cap on both ends. But what I'm going to do is fill the entire thing with a liquid, water and antifreeze, clear. And that will be a very effective barrier against any radiation penetrating into it. So there are a lot of different ways you can do it. Again, I would highly recommend downloading this book right now. In 10 minutes from now, you could be looking at, right in the back here, all these different designs for how to build everything. It's so great to have these visuals here. So download it right now, check it out, and keep your mind open to all the different sort of creative approaches that you can use of what's in your area. So that's it for today. There are more installments in this series coming. I'm not sure of the exact order, but we are going to be talking more about the illnesses that you can get if you are exposed to blast or radiation. We're going to be talking coming up about how to stock your shelter. Right today we've only talked about how to build it structurally. We haven't talked at all about really what to put in there. And I also want to talk about some of the long-term issues. Once you come out of your shelter, what is cleanup going to be like? What are the tools that you're going to want to make sure you have for cleanup? Also, we're going to be talking about long-term issues and And some theoretical things. A lot of people have been talking about nuclear winter. We're gonna address that. Like, how likely is that? What conditions would be necessary for that to occur? And what are possible ways of sort of muddling through and surviving that? So there are more episodes to come. I'm going to be releasing one every week as we go forward. And, well, that's about it for now. Thank you very much for watching.